was the appliance of basic research that changed all this. And there's a good quote here, just Sarkozy. He made a speech last year to the Institute of Physics in Paris, and he says, without basic research, there can be no applications. After all, electricity and the electric light bulb are not invented by incremental improvements in the candle. Right? How do we go from that to that research? You know, basic, fundamental research. It can be left field, it can be irrelevant at the time, and then suddenly it becomes relevant. And in arthritis, a great example is this. So aspirin, this is aspirin here, good chemical there, this is chemistry. That aspirin was a mainstay for arthritis, it's anti-inflammatory. And aspirin will get rid of pain, as you know, with a headache, for instance, it gets rid of swelling. And that was used in arthritis, or drugs like it, for a long time. And then finally, a brand new drug came along called Enbrel. This is a biological agent. It mops up a protein called TNF, which I'll explain in a minute. That's a very high-tech drug. It took an awful lot of basic research, thousands and thousands of people, billions of dollars to go from that to that. And without that basic research, you wouldn't have this treatment. This is for rheumatoid arthritis. And Enbrel is a very interesting drug. And really, as an analogy I'm going to use a few times, it's like a domino effect. So if your disease is the last domino falling over, and this might be rheumatoid arthritis, much of our research in many labs is finding the damn dominoes. Because once we know what the dominoes are, we can stop them falling over. And TNF is a very important domino. It occurs here, it gets knocked over, if you like, drives inflammation and drives rheumatoid. And what Enbrel does is, it mops up TNF. So it stops that domino. 60% of rheumatoid patients respond well to Enbrel. It's made a big difference to people's lives. It doesn't cure the disease, because we don't know what caused the question, what caused it. But at least we know an early player. And if we can stop that player, we can get a therapeutic effect. And even more importantly, it's made in Ireland, Enbrel. It's owned by Pfizer. It's made in Grange Castle. This was in the Financial Times about a month ago. I read this and I decided to make a slide out of it. Enbrel makes 7 billion euros a year for Pfizer. Half the world's supply is made in Grange Castle. And it said every week, 300-200 litre stainless steel containers of Enbrel leave Dublin Port. There's 240,000 doses. It sells for 70 million euro per week. We must get those Somali pirates to hijack that ship. Now, to make it relevant, if I was to fill a can of Coke with Enbrel, it would sell for 42,000 euro. Isn't that amazing? Now, why is it so expensive? Why is it making so much money? All that research costs money. Drug companies are a business. And it works, thankfully. If it didn't work, you'd be unhappy. It works in a lot of cases. So is it worth the price? We could debate that. These drugs are very expensive. But they work in many, many cases. And there's the ship leaving Dublin Port. And there's Grange Castle. Employing about 2,000 people, by the way, for Pfizer. And they're making that drug out. That's a very high-tech drug to make. So really, that typifies a key advance, I suppose. All that research discovered that domino. Pfizer developed a drug to block it, and it's affecting rheumatoid arthritis. Now, it's not just rheumatoid. All of these diseases are inflammatory. You've got osteoarthritis, asthma, MS, Crohn's, colitis, diabetes. It's the second example I'm going to give you in a few minutes. Atherosclerosis, psoriasis. All of these, 25% of the population is afflicted by these diseases. There are these anti-inflammatory agents. There's Enbrel. But still, we've got a long way to go. My lab and many labs are still in the middle of all this because we still need to get better insight into disease mechanisms. And really, in the past 10 years, the big advance is in immunology, in immunity. And that's the story I'm going to tell you. All the great discoveries in the past 10 years in immunology are very relevant to these diseases and giving us a handle on them at last is the way to think of it. And immunology is very important. Even Bill Gates himself, this was in the Financial... I keep reading the Financial Times. Isn't that a wonderful sign, Peter, an academic? Richard Bruton, they'd be very proud of me. He was interviewed in the Financial Times. Immunology is super interesting, so we're all screwed now if Gates thinks that's the case. And he made a great speech, you know, at Harvard, Gates. He said, humanity's greatest advances are not in its discoveries, but in how those discoveries are applied to decrease inequity, which is a great quote. In other words, what this research should really do is make life more equal for people. And inequity can be in health. You're very unlucky to get cancer or arthritis. Or if you've got malaria, that's a developing world disease. You know, and this research should help correct that. And that's why Gates is big into immunology, so it's for that reason. Now, if we don't look, how do we get to the point of TNF, and how do we get better from that 1914 awfulness in terms of rheumatoid, for instance? And this begins with a guy called Metchnikoff. He was a Russian scientist. And in 1908, he won the Nobel Prize. He discovered a key cell called the phagocyte, or we call them now macrophages. So the key cell of the inflammatory process in your bloodstream is called a macrophage. It's a white blood cell. It's the cell, the frontline cell, that recognizes infection, it repairs tissue, it releases some of these inflammatory factors, and really orchestrates the whole process. And it was discovered by this guy, Metchnikoff, in the starfish to begin with, strangely. And the phagocyte, it's a big eater, gobbles up bacteria. That's where the name came from. But very importantly, as ever, an Irishman was done down again for the Nobel Prize. Our medical school is 300 years old, you may know in Trinity. This is one of our graduates, Almuth Wright, and he discovered phagocytes as well. Right? Now, Metchnikoff mentions him in his Nobel speech 8 times, as in, hard luck, I got it, you didn't. There's a great Wikipedia quote I found on him. It says, Wright proposed that logic should be part of medical training, but his idea was never adopted. Which speaks volumes. And then we're so desperate in Trinity to claim famous people. Did you know Wright went to London? His first student was Alexander Fleming. Isn't that amazing? He recruited Fleming into his lab, and of course Fleming discovered antibiotics. Even better, look at this. This is the history of Fleming. But now you know Fleming had a lab, and this mold blew in the window, and it killed bacteria, and penicillin was purified from that mold. Look at this. Where did the mould come from? Most likely the mould came from Latouche's room downstairs. Latouche had been collecting a large sample of moulds for John Freeman, who was researching asthma, and it's likely that some floated up to himself. Latouche was an Irish mycologist, so really it was an Irish man who discovered antibiotics. Now, so Metchnikoff comes along, discovers phagocytes, they're great, and people work on them, and then they get neglected, strange. And immunology doesn't go back to them for about 70 or 80 years, peculiar, isn't it? Strange that it was neglected. And the reason for that was immunologists were mainly caught up in this business. This is vaccination. Now, vaccination was discovered by Jenner, 1798. A vaccine is when you give, for example, cowpox in this particular case, and that protects against smallpox, and it protects for life. So vaccines are wonderful things. Vaccines are normally what we call attenuated versions of a pathogen, like a bacteria, a broken version that doesn't cause disease, but your immune system can recognize it. And then when it sees the real disease, you've got this memory in the system and you're protected, right? And immunology tried to explain that scientifically. And antibodies were discovered. Remember here, antibodies are very important for neutralizing bacteria. T cells are a very important cell type that orchestrate this part of the immune system. And immunology was all about that. And in particular, if we've got pathogens here. This is a macrophage. This is the offending cell we're talking about. And what was happening was they discovered that things called antigens, which are tiny bits of these pathogens, little piece of bacteria, little piece of a virus, were taken up by these macrophages, and that then triggered the immune response. These T and B cells came out. Vaccines work by bringing out these T and B cells. Antibodies get made. But they also knew that these inflammatory factors were made, and there's TNF again, are made by this process. But it was all about the antigen. A little piece of the pathogen was getting taken up here and then activating this process. And that's what immunology was obsessed with until this man came along, Charlie Janeway, 1989, and I got to know him quite well. He wrote a special review at that time called Approaching the Asymptote. And what he said in this review was basically, if we just work on these antibodies and this antigen bit, we won't get any further. He said, the asymptote. He said, our understanding of recognition by antibodies, he means here, is approaching an asymptote. He said, the system must discriminate infectious non-self, that's like bacteria, from non-infectious self, your own body, and he said there must be a system of receptors that can do that. He postulated there were special receptors that could sense pathogens. And out of that came the revolution, and lo and behold, half the immune system was being worked on, the other half wasn't, and a key set of receptors that sense these microbial factors are called the toll-like receptors, TLRs, and I've worked on those for the past 12 years or so. They were the things discovered by Beutler and Hoffman. This whole set of the immune system that senses other bits of the microbe with the antigen, you need both. Both are required to trigger the response. Now, have you ever heard of adjuvants? They're used in vaccines. Adjuvants go through this pathway here and boost a vaccine response, for instance. And nobody ever knew how vaccines were, or adjuvants worked. These receptors sense the adjuvant and then trigger the immune response. And the best analogy I can give you is how ignorant we were. It's as if we were studying the immune system, right? And there were two parts. And all we looked at was Paul McCartney, right? That's how ignorant we were. Half the system was being ignored. And this only began in the late 90s, so in the last 10, 12 years, we realized half the immune system was missing. And it began in the fruit fly. Hoffman first finds these receptors, these special sensors of microbes. He finds them in the fruit fly first, because he worked on flies as a sort of model, like a lab rat. And he made a fly, and here's toll again. He made a fly that lacked toll, and it got fungal infections, which is great. Bruce Beutler, the second guy, was working on mice. And one of the very important microbial products that drives this response goes through a thing called TLR4. And there was a mouse called these mice look identical to you, I bet they look identical to me. In 1965, it was realized that this mouse did not respond to these microbial products. This one did, the HEJ-HEN. And Bruce mapped it to a single gene in that mouse. And the difference in these mice is the TOL4 gene is slightly different in that mouse than that one. There's a single amino acid, if you know any biochemistry, different between these two mice, and that makes that one respond, that one not. And from that then, TOL4 was found to be the key sensor of this microbial product. And again, that's, he won the Nobel Prize for that discovery of Toll 4 sensing this microbial product. And then we end up then with this situation, where these toll-like receptors, their job, they really are the front line of the immune system. They sense these microbial products, and they drive a very complex pathway, and then turn on the inflammatory and immune system. They're essential for that process. They also sense damaged tissue. Now remember I said if you damage tissue, you get inflammation? Damaged tissue releases various factors. The same receptors sense that. So this is the essence of the immune system. It's sensing imbalance here, either a pathogen or damaged tissue. And these four proteins, they trigger the relay of the signal. We discovered one of these in my lab. MAL was discovered in my lab as one of the key signals for the immune system. And that was a great thrill. We purified it and studied it. We made a mouse that lacks MAL, which you can do. You can knock a gene out of a mouse. That mouse hasn't got a functioning immune system. So it was a great thrill to find a key component part of the entire immune system. It can't fight bacteria, can't fight viruses, can't fight malaria, MAL, if you lack MAL. So it's a key switch that gets triggered here. And we begin to unravel all these different component parts. And amazingly, these tolls, now remember what they are, they're sensors of this damage and this infection. Every organism on Earth has tolls to defend itself. That's how conserved it is. I mean, Hoffman finds them in the fruit fly. That was a good organism. He finds them everywhere. Arabidopsis, we use this is a type of mustard, strangely. We use 140 of them. Right? We've only got 10. So we're less than up. The humble potato has 183 of these things. And here's the funny thing. The potato that succumbed to Phytophthora infestans, that particular potato had only half this number. Its immune system was inactive and it succumbed to that fungus. Isn't that interesting? So we can blame the blight on a lack of tolls. Now, good Peter, and in fact, America wouldn't have been built if it wasn't for the emigration that happened because of a defective potato. The sea urchin, I love this organism, has 222 of them. So they're everywhere. And these are the frontline defenders, and again, a good reason for a Nobel Prize. Now, what's the relevance to inflammation? Well, as I said, they're very important in humans. They sense infection in humans. They're very important in rheumatoid arthritis. And our company, Opsona, we've got a biotech company, we're developing an inhibitor, one of these, now they're numbered 1 to 10, toll number 2. Okay, we're blocking that with a special drug. And this is a good example of an experiment. This is someone who has rheumatoid arthritis. If they're having a hip replacement, you can grow that tissue in the lab. You take the old hip out, the tissue will grow in the lab, and study it. And we use that as sort of we call it ex vivo, as a way to study disease. And in this tissue, it pumps out TNF. And here's, remember, this is the damaging molecule. Into that tissue mix, if you put a Toll-2 inhibitor, you block TNF. Look at that, you get rid of all the TNF, goes down dramatically. IL-6 is another one. So this Toll-2 inhibitor is stopping arthritis in a dish. And of course, that's very interesting. Now we're going to develop that, hopefully, as a drug. And the way to think of it is this, my dominoes again. Like my earlier slide was, what, 90s, but we now know earlier dominoes. It's the Toll-like receptors that initiate, and then we get the TNF. And Toll-2 in particular, that drug is effectively keeping that domino up and stopping TNF from being made. And then the rest of the dominoes don't fall. And what's very important, there's MAL. MAL is a key adapter that gets knocked over as well. So that's part of the process, the relay. And what's very important is we're very close now to the cause of disease here. These things are very early. They're driving these signals very early in the cascade of events. And that's why this discovery counts for so much, I guess.